In this second part of the lecture, covering the pharmacology of drugs used for treatment of cancer, we are going to discuss antimetabolites. So in the last lecture on cancer drugs, we covered agents that mostly affected cells in the G1 phase of the cell cycle. In this presentation, we'll shift our focus to agents that affect the S phase of the cycle. Now, in order to gain better understanding of how these agents work, first let's take a closer look at what exactly happens during the S phase. So as you may remember, during the S phase, DNA is replicated. DNA replication begins when an enzyme topoisomerase unwinds coiled DNA, and an enzyme DNA helicase breaks the bonds between complementary nucleotide bases. This exposes the bases, which are of two types, purines and pyrimidines. The purines are adenine and guanine, and the pyrimidines are cytosine and thymine. Now, once the DNA strand is open, with the help of an enzyme called DNA polymerase, each nucleotide base is then bonded to a new free-floating partner. Adenine pairs with thymine, and guanine pairs with cytosine to form a new strand of DNA, which is essentially an exact copy of the original version. Now, the metabolic requirements for the nucleotides and their bases can be met by both dietary intake and synthesis from smaller precursors, known as de novo synthesis. Cancer cells are actually highly dependent on the de novo synthesis of nucleotides to maintain sufficient pools to support DNA replication and the production of RNA. Now, although both purine and pyrimidine bases are found in nucleotides, they are made in different ways. So first, let's take a look at the synthesis of purines, which begins with the formation of nucleotide called inosine monophosphate, IMP for short, from phosphoribosyl pyrophosphate, PRPP for short, amino acids, and folate. Now, IMP represents a branch point, because it can be converted into either adenosine monophosphate, AMP for short, or guanosine monophosphate, GMP for short. Conversion of IMP to AMP requires a synthase enzyme that converts IMP to adenylosuccinate, and then lyase enzyme that converts adenylosuccinate into AMP. AMP can be then reduced to deoxy-AMP and further converted to deoxy-ATP, which can be incorporated into DNA. Alternatively, conversion of IMP to GMP requires dehydrogenase enzyme that catalyzes the conversion of IMP to xanthosine monophosphate, XMP for short, which serves as a substrate for the production of GMP. Likewise, GMP can be reduced to deoxy-GMP and then converted into deoxy-GTP, which is incorporated into DNA. Now, let's take a look at the synthesis of pyrimidines. So, unlike purine synthesis, pyrimidine synthesis begins with the formation of nitrogenous base called orotate, which combines with phosphoribosyl pyrophosphate to form uridine monophosphate, UMP for short. As a branch point in pyrimidine synthesis, UMP can be phosphorylated to uridine triphosphate, UTP for short, aminated to cytidine triphosphate, CTP for short, and then reduced to deoxy-CTP, which is incorporated into DNA. Alternatively, UMP can be reduced to deoxy-UMP, and then converted to deoxythymidine monophosphate, DTMP for short, by an enzyme called thymidylate synthase. In the final step, DTMP is converted to deoxythymidine triphosphate, DTTP for short, which is incorporated into DNA. Now, it's important to note here that thymidylate synthase is a key enzyme that participates in folate metabolism. In order to convert DUMP to DTMP, thymidylate synthase uses methylene tetrahydrofolate as a methyl group donor, resulting in the formation of dihydrofolate that in turn is reduced to tetrahydrofolate by dihydrofolate reductase. Finally, methylene tetrahydrofolate is regenerated from tetrahydrofolate in a one-carbon transfer reaction. Now that we covered basic overview of purine and pyrimidine biosynthesis, let's move on to discussing mechanism of action of antimetabolites. So antimetabolites tend to exert greatest cytotoxicity in the S phase of the cell cycle by simply interfering with the de novo synthesis of purines and pyrimidines. In order to understand how these drugs work, first let's go back to our overview of the de novo purine synthesis. Perhaps one of the most well-known antimetabolites that interferes with this pathway is a drug called mercaptopurine, often abbreviated as 6-MP. Mercaptopurine is a prodrug that upon entry into the cell, it is first converted to thioinosine monophosphate, TIMP for short, by an enzyme called hypoxanthine-guanine phosphoribosyl transferase, AGPRT for short. AGPRT is an enzyme that plays a key role in the recycling of the purine bases, hypoxanthine and guanine. Now, TIMP inhibits several chemical reactions involving inosine monophosphate, including the conversion of IMP to xanthosine monophosphate and the conversion of IMP to adenylosuccinate. Furthermore, through series of reactions, TIMP can be converted into thioguanosine triphosphate, TGTP, which then can be incorporated into RNA, as well as thiodeoxyguanosine triphosphate, TDGTP, which can be incorporated into DNA, thus leading to inhibition of both DNA and RNA synthesis, resulting in cell death. Now let's move on to the next anti-metabolite drug, that is hydroxyurea. The main target of hydroxyurea is an enzyme that is responsible for conversion of ribonucleotides into deoxyribonucleotides, called ribonucleotide reductase, RNR for short. Hydroxyurea inhibits this enzyme, which results in nucleotide deprivation, stalling of replication fork progression, and ultimately S-phase cell cycle arrest in proliferating cells. Now, ribonucleotide reductase is also a major target of other purine antimetabolites, such as cladribine and fludarabine. The first one, cladribine, is activated mostly in lymphocytes when it's converted to its toxic metabolite, 2-chlorodeoxyadenosine triphosphate, 2-CDATP for short. In proliferating cells, 2-CDATP not only interferes with ribonucleotide reductase, but also acts as a DNA polymerase inhibitor by competing with the binding of DATP to that enzyme. In addition to that, unlike other anti-metabolite drugs, cladribine has cytotoxic effects on resting lymphocytes. In resting cells, cladribine causes a single-strand DNA breaks, inducing the DNA repair enzyme, which in turn exhausts the intracellular pools of nicotinamide adenine dinucleotide NAD and adenosine triphosphate ATP, thus causing apoptotic cell death. Now, moving on to our next anti-metabolite drug, fludarabine. So fludarabine also requires conversion to the active metabolite, in this case arabinosyl 2-fluoroadenine triphosphate, FRATP for short. Once formed, FRATP inhibits ribonucleotide reductase and competes with DATP for incorporation into the elongating DNA strand by DNA polymerase, thus terminating DNA synthesis at the incorporation site. Lastly, FRATP inhibits two additional enzymes that are crucial for DNA synthesis, that is, DNA primase, an enzyme that synthesizes short RNA sequences called primers, which serve as a starting point for DNA synthesis, and DNA ligase 1, an enzyme required for joining of short DNA fragments to create the lagging strand during DNA replication. Now let's switch gears and let's move on to discussing anti-metabolites that affect de novo synthesis of pyrimidines. Here, just like in the purine synthesis pathway, hydroxyurea inhibits ribonucleotide reductase, which converts ribonucleotides into deoxyribonucleotides. Another anti-metabolite that interferes with pyrimidine synthesis is a drug called gemcitabine. So upon entry into the cell, gemcitabine gets rapidly phosphorylated to form active metabolites. Gemcitabine diphosphate, abbreviated DFD-CDP, followed by gemcitabine triphosphate, abbreviated DFD-CTP. The first active metabolite, gemcitabine diphosphate, inhibits ribonucleotide reductase that converts cytidine diphosphate to deoxycytidine monophosphate in the so-called salvage pathway through which nucleosides are recycled. As a result, deoxycytidine triphosphate pools are depleted, which in turn makes it easier for the second active metabolite, DFD-CTP, to come in and insert itself into DNA. Interestingly, insertion of DFD-CTP into DNA allows further insertion of an additional base pair before DNA polymerase is inhibited, thus making DNA repair more difficult. This action is called mask termination. Now, another anti-metabolite analog of cytidine is a drug called cytarabine. Similarly to gemcitabine, Upon entry into the cell, cytarabine is sequentially phosphorylated by kinase enzymes to its active metabolite, cytarabine triphosphate, abbreviated ARA-CTP. ARA-CTP is a potent inhibitor of DNA polymerases and is also incorporated into replicating strands, leading to termination of DNA synthesis directly at the site of incorporation. Now finally, let's move on to discussing antimetabolites that interfere with the last critical step of pyrimidine synthesis, that is conversion of DUMP to DDMP. The first drug that we are going to discuss is an agent called fluorouracil, often abbreviated as 5-FU. So just like the other antimetabolites, fluorouracil requires few enzymatic conversions to form its active metabolites, 5-fluorodeoxyuridine monophosphate, abbreviated 5-FDUMP, and 5-fluorodeoxyuridine triphosphate, abbreviated 5-FUTP. The first one, 5-FDUMP, acts as an inhibitor of thymidylate synthase, the enzyme that methylates DUMP to form DTMP. The second metabolite, 5-FUTP, mimics uridine triphosphate and is recognized as the substrate and incorporated into RNA by RNA polymerase, leading to inhibition of RNA synthesis and function. Now, historically, it was only possible to give fluorouracil intravenously, as the oral bioavailability was poor and unpredictable. This has been overcome by development of the well-tolerated, more bioavailable oral alternative called capecitabine. After being absorbed through the intestine, capecitabine, which itself is non-toxic, undergoes a series of enzymatic reactions to form active drug, that is, fluorouracil. The final step in this reaction is catalyzed by thymidine phosphorylase, an enzyme that happens to be concentrated primarily in tumor tissues, which gives capecitabine greater selective toxicity than fluorouracil. Now let's move on to our last antimetabolite drug, that is methotrexate. So methotrexate enters cells through the reduced folate carrier, abbreviated RFC1, and is intracellularly converted to the active metabolite methotrexate polyglutamate. Polyglutamated methotrexate then inhibits two key enzymes in the folic acid pathway, dihydrofolate reductase, which reduces dihydrofolate to tetrahydrofolate, and thymidylate synthase, which converts DUMP to DTMP. As a result, tetrahydrofolate and DTMP pools become depleted, ultimately leading to cessation of DNA synthesis. Now, when it comes to side effects associated with antimetabolites, the ones that occur commonly include nausea, vomiting, mouth sores, hair loss, and myelosuppression that can lead to fatigue, anemia, bleeding, or increased risk of infections. And with that, I wanted to thank you for watching. I hope you enjoyed this video, and as always, stay tuned for more.